Good afternoon. My name is Marty Shaw. I'm the science teacher here at the Delphian School in Sheridan, Oregon. We've decided that because a lot of students aren't able to attend school because of health concerns, we would have some videos to show you some things that perhaps you could do at home, or at least you might find interesting. I've been teaching here since 1995. This is my associate, Diego Martinez. Diego is an award-winning science teacher, and we're here to make science fun and interesting.
Hello. Welcome.
In case you hear birds in the background, we have some finches here in the lab, and so they might be making a little bit of noise from time to time. All right, let's get started. The name of this course is Everyday Chemistry, and it's designed for middle school students. And so one of the things they talk about is clothing. When you think of clothing, you think of cotton or wool or leather, but a lot of clothing is made chemically. For instance, polyester and various other chemicals make up clothing. We're not going to be doing everything in this course. We're just going to be doing a few interesting talks about different chemicals and different experiments. First thing that we're going to talk about are atoms and molecules. So atoms are very, very tiny pieces of matter. And we can show them like this. Each one of these would be an atom, or like this, but they're very, very small. So this would be, for instance, an atom of sodium or some other element. And when you have two or more atoms combined, two different kinds of atoms, or two or more different kinds of atoms, that's called a compound. So these are both compounds, and we'll talk about that a little later. Let's see. So we're going to jump right into candle chemistry. So here I have a candle, and I'm going to light this. Now, candles are made up of two elements, only two. They're made up of carbon, and they're made up of hydrogen. Lots of them. There's a picture here in the book to give you an idea. This is this compound, this big old compound of wax. And when I burn it, it produces, the carbon combines with the oxygen to form carbon dioxide, and the hydrogen combines with the oxygen to form water. So I'm going to put this over the top. So now it's preventing any air from coming in. And so in a minute or so, the candle should go out. And you might be able to see around the edge a little bit of a cloud there. And that cloudiness is because of moisture or water. So as soon as this goes out, I'm going to bring this close to the camera. So you see that moisture there? That moisture was caused by the water vapor, or the water in the form of a gas. We're going to do something else with a candle now. We'll light it up again. And here's just some aluminum foil like you would have at home. And if I take it and fold it, and I put this in here, you might see some black smoke coming here. Can you see that? So this black is carbon, because I wasn't letting the candle get enough oxygen. And so some of the carbon, remember, candles made of carbon and hydrogen, some of the carbon appeared here you might have seen something like that at campfires or in lanterns and that sort of thing. If you have any questions, don't forget there's a Q&A box on your computer. You could press it and send in a question and I'd be happy to answer it. I'm gonna do one more thing. Well, we'll do a couple more things. As long as we have the candle there, I'm gonna light this and then I'm going to blow this out and you'll see some smoke coming out. And what I'm gonna try and do is relight the smoke. It's really a candle as a gas form candle. So let's see if I can relight it. Did you see it? Did you see that jump? We'll try it again. So that's something that's really cool because most people think, well, that's just smoke. Actually, it's not. That is one more thing. We have some water here. I'm going to put some water in here. And I have a little food coloring just for fun. Diego, would you light that candle for me?
Sure.
Thank you. So now I'm just going to use this to mix the blue food coloring. So we have water that's a little blue. And now I'm going to take this bottle. Now I chose this bottle because of its shape, but any kind of bottle would do. If you wanted to use something like that, that would work just fine also. And I'm gonna put this over the top. And when I do, you might see bubbles in the water. And then let's see what happens. So I'm gonna put this on top. Did you see the bubbles? And now,
cool.
So why does it do that? Well, look at how high it's going. What happens is when the air in here gets hot, it takes up more space. That was the bubbles you saw escaping because the air in here was very hot. When there's no more oxygen left, the candle goes out. And the air in here cools and takes up less space, and the water rushes in to take over the empty space. And so that's why that happened. Let's try that again with this bottle. Okay. So if you do this a second time, sometimes the candle's a little wet, so you might have to might sputter a little.
Did it dry out pretty good?
Mm-hmm. Well, no. Yeah.
It's trying.
There we go.
There we go.
So now I'm going to do the same thing just with this bottle and watch what happens. Did you see the bubbles? And the water comes in, look at that. All I have to do is get the candle out.
And if you're at home, we're not expecting you to follow along with this at home, so don't worry about that.
Right.
We're in a lab and we're trained professionals.
Okay, so a section of this book now talks about oxidation. And that's a big fancy word, and all it means is something combining with oxygen. So before, when we lit a match, the oxygen in the air is combining with the wood here, and that's oxidation. So this is a form of oxidation, but there are other forms of oxidation.
Do you have a question?
Yes, we have a question.
Alette asked, does it matter if it's a plastic or gas or glass bottle?
Well, if it's a plastic bottle, what could happen is once you put this over, it'll bubble, but then when it cools down, the plastic might shrink. So I'd recommend a glass bottle, because otherwise what's going to happen is your bottle's just going to go like that and get smaller.
Another question is, would it make a difference if no food coloring? This is from Amelia.
No, Amelia. Food coloring is there just to make it a little more dramatic so you can see it.
Great.
Okay.
And Logan asks, would it work without fire?
No. The fire is what makes this thing work, because when I put this over, the air in here gets hot. And we know that hot air takes up more space. And so those were the bubbles you saw coming out. And then when the fire starts to go out, the air starts to cool, takes up less space, and the water comes back in to take up the space that the bubbles left. So you need to have fire for this experiment. Okay. So now we're going to do a couple of experiments with steel wool. Now, they call this steel wool because it's made of steel, which is a combination of iron and other elements. Yes.
One other question from Milo on the, what if no bubbles went out for the other one?
Okay. If no bubbles went out, it's probably because you put it down too slowly. You need to put it down pretty quickly. Once you get it lit, you need to put it down quickly. Okay, so we're going to do a couple of things with steel wool. So this is steel wool. They sell this at the hardware store, but sometimes you could just get, this is a very fine steel wool. They make all different types of steel wool. Some types are heavier. This is very thin. People use it if they're cleaning something off, or they want to sand something down to make it smooth. This is the sort of thing that they can use. And so I'm just taking this little bit of steel wool and stretching it. And Diego, if you would light that candle for me.
Okay.
Not much left from our poor little candle.
Okay.
That sound you hear, that sputtering, is because of the water. The candle got water on it. So now I'm just going to put this right above the candle, and then I'm going to lift it up so you can see what happens. I might even bring it a little closer to the camera.
Ooh.
So this is the, you never knew that iron could burn. But that's exactly what we're doing. We're burning this iron. And now it's a combination of iron and oxygen. This is another example of oxidation. So if I put it in the flame again, do you think it's going to do the same thing? Well, let's try it. Oops. Well, now it's not going to do the same thing, but this is dry. No, it's not really doing it. Why not? Why didn't this burn again? Well, think about it. If I burn a match completely and then put it in the fire, will it burn a second time? No. And the same thing is true of the steel wool. The steel wool has burned. We're going to do something else with steel wool.
We have a question.
We have a couple questions.
A couple of questions.
One earlier, what if you use something else to light up besides the candle?
Like, well, you could do, candles are convenient because they're thin.
This is from Tita.
But I suppose if you had a match and put it in here and put the bottle over the match, that would work as long as the match doesn't go out.
Well, there's always Cheetos.
And then we also have a question from Sophia and Juliana. What makes the bubbles appear? So that's from Sophia, that specifically.
Okay. Well, when I put this over the top, the air, what happens to the temperature of the air when this is, when this goes over the top? The air in here gets hot. And when you have air that gets hot, it takes up more space. And so that's why it had bubbles coming out, because those bubbles were from the air that was in here that was getting hot, that took up more space and didn't have any more space in here because this was a glass jar. And so the only place it could go is outside, and that's the bubbles you saw. And then when the air in here got cooler, when the flame went out, the air took up less space and the water came in to take up the place that the missing air would have been in.
Cool.
I hope that answered your question.
Veronica or her children have the question, what is the material that water is laying on?
Oh, this is just a plate, a little plastic plate that I have. You could use anything like that, any kind of plate or bowl, and that would work just fine.
Okay. And then one more or a couple. Why does the iron light up like that? Real iron doesn't do that, does it?
Well, this is real iron. But most of the iron you see is a big chunk and there's not a lot of air in it. This, I spread out these little pieces and so there's a lot of air in here. And so, because there's a lot of air, there's a lot of room for the iron to burn. But it seems kind of strange to think iron burning, but that's exactly what we did. Do I want to do this again?
Yeah.
Sure.
I also had a question. Could you do it with not the thin steel wool?
You could do it with steel wool that's a little thicker, but it's not as dramatic.
Okay.
Look at that.
Milo is asking, would it work if it was wet?
Well, let's try it. What do you think, Milo? What if the match is wet? Do you think a match would burn if it was wet? We could try it. Now, if I could dry it off fast enough in the flame, it might, but let's see. So I'm going to put this in here and get this wet. Just the edges where it started to dry out. Not really as dramatic. There's another way though to light steel wool on fire. Do we have any more steel wool? And that is, if I take steel wool and I hold it like that, and I have here a little battery. And so iron conducts electricity. So when I put this steel wool by these two edges of the battery, it's going to get hot and it should light it on fire. And it does. And if you do this at home, make sure there's an adult there. We don't want you to burn your house down. And neither do your parents.
Kai is asking, is it safe to breathe that?
Yes, it doesn't give out any fumes that are toxic.
Another question is, are there any other objects besides steel wool that light up like that?
Yeah, there are. Let me get a candle and a chemical and I'll show you, see if I can show you one.
Another question is, does it have to be a specific battery?
No, any kind of battery.
9-volt works best because it has a little more voltage.
Put that in and light that up.
Diego, maybe you can answer a couple of the other questions.
Sure, sure.
What is fire made out of?
What is fire made out of?
I'm glad you got that one.
Fire is made out of, fire is energy. Fire is energy. You're seeing it's right when energy, when you have solid things turning into gas things. So you're looking at the energy transformation as solids turns as solids turn into gases. And Marty, if you have anything to add to that question, feel free.
Yeah, fire just shows that there's a chemical change going on and something is combining with oxygen.
Okay.
Now, I don't know, now that I think about it, if this is going to be hot enough.
Okay.
So I'm going to try this.
Logan asks, how does it light it on fire if the battery is closed?
If the battery is closed. Well, I'm not sure what you mean, but what happens is when these two get connected, electricity flows from one end to the other, from this end to that end, and it gets the steel wool hot enough where it burns.
Just like a kitchen stove, when you have electricity going through those coils on top of your stove, it gets really red hot.
So I'm gonna try this. This is just an alcohol burner. And this is iron powder. And I just put this. And I'm gonna put it right here so you can see it a little better. And look at that. What do you think this is used for in real life?
Have them answer.
You have an answer?
Yeah, tell them to answer. They can answer.
What do you
the
think?
Q&A.
What do you think? What do you think this is? This will give you a clue. Take a look at that. What do you think this is used for?
Sparklers. Milo's saying sparklers.
Sparklers. Yeah, but mainly it's used for fireworks. As a matter of fact, fireworks. Where's my other one? I should probably shut my phone off. Okay, now here is something else that's used in fireworks. This is the metal magnesium. And this might take a little longer to get going. But this is also used in fireworks. Also, sparklers. You can see why it's used in sparklers. Okay?
Kai asks, have you ever made something go boom on your face?
No, I try not to do that. And when we're working here in the lab with dangerous chemicals and things that might go boom in my face, I wear an apron to cover my clothes, and I wear goggles to cover my eyes.
Sophia and Juliana said that is cool. And Kelly asked, what's metal magnesium?
Oh, it's just another kind of metal. There are lots of metals. Do you remember that periodic table handle? So here's a table of the elements. And so everything from my hand over this way, all of these are metals. Here's good old iron. This is what we used in the steel wool. And this is what we used with the iron powder here. And magnesium is right over here. It's just another metal. Most elements are metals. Okay. Thank you, Diego.
Someone's asking if we still have the chinchilla from 2016.
I still have the chinchilla. Yes. Okay, so I'm going to move this out of the way. Okay, thank you.
Well, this is an interesting question. Can you make art with science?
Absolutely. Boy, that's a great question, and I love doing that. You can make lots of different art, types of art with science. There are too many for me to mention, but what a great question that is. Okay. So here, I'm gonna put some baking soda. Could you get some baking soda and put it in here?
How much are you talking about?
Keep going. Yeah, okay. And now pour some vinegar in there. So what you see, the bubbles there, what we're making here, those bubbles are bubbles of carbon dioxide gas. Now, fires need oxygen, but carbon dioxide gas is a little heavier than oxygen. And so if I poured carbon dioxide gas here, what would happen is, because it's heavier, it would sink down at the bottom, preventing the candles from getting oxygen. Let's see what happens. Come on, come on, come on. There we go. So we made carbon dioxide by combining baking soda and vinegar. These are things you can find around the house. And now, if I took, let's see, add a little more vinegar to this.
Good. We have another question. What is the most exciting thing about chemistry? This is from Evan.
Well, you know, chemistry is the science that describes in detail how our bodies work, how things react with one another, how we make food or how plants make food, how we digest food and get to use food. Chemistry is really all things. It encompasses or takes in all things. And so, I mean, there's so many fascinating things about chemistry. It's hard to just choose one thing. But I'm going to show you this. So here's our match, and it's burning in the air because, right, there's oxygen. But what about in here? Is there oxygen in here? Let's see. No. The oxygen went out. The oxygen is not in here. This had the carbon dioxide gas that we need. Okay. I'm going to use a little bit of this now. Ask you to throw that out. Sure. And
one of the most exciting things I think about chemistry is rocket fuel.
Oh yeah.
I love watching rockets go up, and I had a student here at Delphian that he's making rocket fuel for Mars. So he's working out the chemistry on how to do that. Really cool.
We've had students do projects where they'll take an old rocket engine and they'll make their own rocket fuel and put it in this old burned out engine and ignite it, and it'll fly out of sight. Really fun.
Juliana asks, what is carbon dioxide used for?
Oh, carbon dioxide is used to put out fires, and it's used by plants. Plants use carbon dioxide to form food. You know, where we breathe in oxygen and we breathe out carbon dioxide gas, and plants do the opposite. They take in carbon dioxide gas and water and sunlight, and they make food and give out oxygen. So that's why plants are so important. If we didn't have plants, we would have used up all the oxygen on the planet long ago, and we'd all, you know, wouldn't be alive. Plants enable us to continue to live.
One other question, can carbon dioxide be harmful if you breathe it in a cup?
Well, it's not good for you because your body doesn't need it, but there's carbon dioxide here and it's coming out, and it's not dangerous. It's only dangerous if there's no oxygen, because don't forget, when you're breathing out carbon dioxide. So it's just, as long as there's oxygen around for you to breathe, a little bit of carbon dioxide isn't going to hurt you.
It's like when your head's under the covers for too long.
Yeah.
You just need oxygen.
Right. Okay, so I'm going to take this. And I'm going to take this.
Milo asked, do firefighters use carbon dioxide from fire hydrants?
No, they use water from fire hydrants. But Some fire extinguishers use carbon dioxide. And the fire extinguisher, of course, puts out a fire. So this was an interesting experiment. I'm going to light a candle. And now I'm going to take a sugar cube. This is just a sugar cube that I got at the store. And if I try and burn it, it doesn't burn. It gets black on it, but it doesn't burn. Here is this other chemical. And if I put this other chemical in, it doesn't burn either. But something interesting happens when I combine the two. So now I'm just going to melt a little of this sugar and dip it in here. So you don't have this chemical at home, but this chemical is the same chemical that's in cigarette ash. So cigarette ash doesn't burn, it's already burned out. But if you combine sugar, it even blew that out. If you combine sugar with cigarette ash and you put it on a flame or a candle, it'll burn. I'm gonna try that again.
Someone asks, what is on the match or matchbox that makes fire appear on the match?
Great question. Can you see this burning? So, there are some matches where you can rub it on sandpaper and they'll ignite. Those are called strike anywhere matches. But I believe it's phosphorus. Do you know for sure, Diego?
I don't know for sure. Good question.
I think it's phosphorus. And the chemical here combines, these are called strike on box matches, because the second chemical it needs is right on here. And when the two chemicals combine with a little bit of heat from me rubbing it, that happens.
Someone said, you had a picture, this is Evan, you had a picture of carbon dioxide, but doesn't oxygen get in there too because it's exposed to the air?
I had a picture of
a picture. You had a picture.
Oh, a picture. Yeah. Yeah. But remember, carbon dioxide is heavier than oxygen, than the air. And so it's going to want to stay in here. Just like the water isn't coming out, the water's staying in here because it's heavier than the air. Carbon dioxide is also heavier than the air. So it'll stay in the pitcher. And that's why I could pour it out. Because once I tilt it like that, then the carbon dioxide could come out. Good question.
Sorry, I'm not getting to everyone's question. I'm trying. It's a lot of questions.
Okay. There's one part here that I want to go over with you now. So this talks about soap and what soap is. Soap has one part which loves water and another part which loves grease or oil. And so, since there's been this virus going around, I wanted to show you a picture of a virus and explain why washing your hands with soap works. So here's the virus, or a picture of the virus. This is just a picture, of course. And here's the inside, and outside is a protein and a fat. Now remember, one part of the soap loves water, and the other part loves oil or fat. And so what happens is, when you have a virus, the water comes in, and the part that loves the fat goes here and breaks it up. You see it breaking up the virus? And then the water, the rest of the soap, surrounds the virus, and when you rinse your hand, it kills the virus and you wash the virus away. That's why it's important to wash your hands and not just with water, but with soap, and rub your hands, because that's what will take this and make the soap break up the virus and kill it.
Logan asks, why does soap make bubbles?
Because the soap combines with the water and it combines with air. And why does the soap make bubbles? I don't know, I've never thought of that. Do you have an answer for that, Diego?
That's a great question.
Monica, we're getting great questions here.
But I think as you learn chemistry, like all chemists, you there's more things to explore, more things to learn about. So I am going to dive into that and make sure I have an answer in the future for that.
Amelia asked, do plants have to breathe?
Absolutely. Plants have to breathe to survive. And plants have two kinds of breathing. They breathe during the day when it's sunny, and they take in carbon dioxide and water and make food and oxygen. But they also use a little bit of the oxygen, a tiny bit of the oxygen that they make. They make a lot of oxygen and they use a little bit of it, and that helps them grow.
Okay. Emmett asks, what is grease and oil made out of?
Grease and oil is a type of chemical, and it has carbon and hydrogen in it. And it doesn't like to mix with water. It likes to stay by itself. Okay, what else do we have?
10 more minutes.
All right. Let's try this. This is an antacid tablet. Sometimes grown-ups take this when they've eaten too much or eaten the wrong kind of food. And if they take this and they put it in, well, let's get a little bit of vinegar. And we add a little vinegar to it.
Antacid and vinegar.
Thank you, Diego. Can you see what's happening? The antacid tablet is reacting with the vinegar and making carbon dioxide gas. There's our old friend carbon dioxide again. As a matter of fact, I think we're going to do the casein next.
Milo asks, what makes up UV light?
UV light is ultraviolet light, and there's a certain amount of light that's visible to the eye. We can see the colors of the rainbow. That's visible light. UV has a higher frequency, so light comes in waves. And so different colors of light have different sizes of waves. Some might be a little longer, some might be a little shorter. They're all very, 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 very tiny waves. And so UV light is even shorter than that, and our eyes can't see it. I think some animals, some tests have been done on animals, and some animals can see UV light, but our eyes can't.
And some telescopes work on UV also.
Right, some telescopes work on UV.
Logan asks, is that Tums or gonna antacid gonna dissolve all the way?
Right, so if I leave it in there long enough, it's bubbling and it's gonna dissolve. Now, antacids aren't the only thing that'll dissolve. Here I have a seashell. And if I put it in here and I put a little acid, this is the kind of acid that that people have in their stomachs that help dissolve food. But you can see that it's also bubbling. Mm. Okay, as a matter of fact, do we have an egg over there? Yeah, right there.
Mitchell has a follow-up to Milo's question. Why do certain things glow in UV light?
Why do certain things glow in UV light?
Well, anything glows because it has a certain frequency that it's able to store those electrons, and then it's able to store those photons and then re-release them. So things can glow from all kinds of different, depending on the type of material and what it's capable of absorbing and then re-emitting.
Okay. Now here's an egg, and earlier today, I put it in some vinegar. Can you see what's happening there? You see the bubbles on the egg? So these bubbles, just like the antacid tablet, and just like the seashell, when a chicken lays an egg, it has a coating on it. And this coating will react with acids, and it'll form, what do you suppose it's gonna form? Extra credit. Anybody know? It forms, these bubbles are carbon dioxide gas, as are the bubbles from here and the bubbles from the seashell.
Evan asked, why doesn't acid burn through the container?
Oh, there's only one or two acids that I know of that would burn through a glass container. It would have to be a very powerful acid indeed to be able to burn through a container like that. And again, this is the type of acid we have in our stomach to help dissolve food. Now we're gonna try one more. Oh, let's make some gag.
Kai asked, why do eggs smell? Do they have a gas? Is gas a smell?
Well, eggs smell because they have a gas in them called hydrogen sulfide. And hydrogen sulfide really smells bad. It smells like rotten eggs. As a matter of fact, do we have a little bowl or
Alette is asking, will vinegar dissolve the egg?
Vinegar will dissolve the egg, yes. So what's gonna happen in a day or so, look at all those bubbles coming out. What's gonna happen in a day or so is this egg is going to be, the shell's gonna be completely gone, and the part that we normally think of as clear, or when it's cooked, the part that's white, that's going to be a like a rubbery kind of a substance. Now this is a fun thing to do. I'm just getting some glue, white glue that you can get at the store, and I'm putting it in here. You've probably done this yourself before. And now I'm gonna take a little food coloring just for fun and add a couple of drops. Can you get the box of the...
Can Amelia's asking, how can acid burn through skin?
Well, there are some acids that can burn through your skin. And you have to be very careful with those acids because they could damage your skin. If they get into your eyes, they could blind you. That's why you have to be very careful with some very, very strong acids. Vinegar is not a strong acid, but it's strong enough to eat away at the shell of an egg. And it's strong enough to hurt you if you get some in your eyes. So be very careful, even with vinegar, and don't get any in your eyes.
Okay. Someone asked, please tell me, why do you have stomach acid?
You have stomach acid because when you eat food, such as protein like eggs or meat or fish, you don't have these little particles floating through your blood. What happens is your body has to break them down into little simple parts. And the way it does that is with acid. The protein can get dissolved with the acid. You also have saliva or the spit. That's a chemical that starts breaking down things like crackers and bread. And that's why when you start eating bread, it doesn't taste sweet. But if you chew on it for a while, it does start to taste sweet because the starch is made up of many, many sugars linked together. But the saliva will break it up into little sugars. And so it'll start to taste sweet. So here is some borax. This you can get at the store, just like you can get the glue. And I dissolved some of it in water. And now you know what this is, but I can pour a little of this in here and mix it up and let's see what happens.
What was being dissolved, was that acid a vinegar? All of them were vinegar that you were using to dissolve?
This was vinegar. This acid, hydrochloric acid, the same kind you have in your stomach.
But it's not actually stomach acid. It's not right. From
this,
a stomach.
This didn't come from your stomach. Yes. We didn't have to pump somebody's stomach out to get this acid. So now, this is not glue at all. A chemical change has occurred. And now we have this stuff that's sort of squishy and gooey. Mix it a little more with my fingers here. And so what we've made here, I've heard kids call this gack.
Logan says slime.
Slime, right. Slime's another word for it. So there are two kinds. Now, if I added water to the glue, it would make more of a kind of a stretchy, gooey slime. But this is more of a bouncy slime. So if I took it and I bounced it, it sort of bounces a little. We call this bouncy slime. Okay.
We are just towards the end, but we have a few more questions that I think they would like answered.
Sure.
Danica is asking, would the egg be edible after it soaked in vinegar like a pickled egg?
Well, you know, I've never tried to eat it, but I don't see why I don't know how well it would taste. If you like vinegar, you could probably cook it and it would probably be fine. What do you think, Diego?
Yeah, I think a person can eat raw eggs, and I mean, you don't want to eat raw eggs as long as they're clean. But with vinegar, it kills most of the stuff in there, so you could eat it.
As a matter of fact, I think there's a Chinese dish called thousand-year-old eggs where they use a type of vinegar, and it makes the eggs look very old, but they're edible.
Okay.
Delicious.
And then someone said, I'm pretty sure the vinegar dissolves the calcium in the eggshell after a while. That's why after a few days, it feels like rubber, right?
Exactly right.
And I think, so someone is asking, what is a non-Newtonian fluid? I don't think we got to that point.
Didn't get to it. Do we have time to do this quickly?
I think we're pretty much done, but if they want to stay for a few more minutes,
stay for a few more minutes, you're welcome to, and we'll make some non-Newtonian
fluid. Logan says, bye, Marty. Also, I still have the necklace. This is Logan from...
Oh, great. Okay, so I'm going to put this in here and let you make your non-Newtonian fluid. So while Diego's doing that, let me just remind you that the cure for boredom is curiosity. And if you're curious about something and want to know how something works, you never have to be bored. Okay, what do we have here, Diego?
All right, so to make a non-Newtonian fluid, well, there's a lot of non-Newtonian fluids, but chocolate, a lot of people don't know that, but chocolate is a non-Newtonian fluid.
That's my favorite non-Newtonian fluid.
Mine too. So this is, we have cornstarch here. So I'm putting in some cornstarch and all we need is water. Cornstarch and water makes a really cool non-Newtonian. Do we have water here?
Is there water in there? Oh yeah, so this is yeast. So we just had some yeast growing. I have some yeast and some sugar.
Warm water.
And warm water, and it smells like bread. That's yeast growing. That's one of the things they show you how to do in this book.
Kai's asking, what is Newtonian?
Newtonian refers to a man named Sir Isaac Newton, and he had these ideas about chemistry. He was a very, very smart man, and he had these ideas about chemistry and how liquids act and how solids act. And so this is sort of a liquid, but not quite. And it's sort of a solid, but not quite. So it's sort of not something that this man named Newton thought about. So that's why they call it a non-Newtonian fluid. A fluid is anything that flows. It could be a liquid or it could be a gas. Air is a fluid.
And Milo's asking, it's called oobleck when you mix it?
Yes.
All right, so I'm mixing this up. We did this it's a local fair called Turkey Rama, and we had a big barrel of it that you could walk through. It was really fun. Kids are
more of this?
Yeah, we need some more.
We have one other question from Cosmo asking, would a plant live in a container of carbon dioxide?
A plant would live in a container of carbon dioxide if it got water and if it got sunlight.
Great question.
And if it was warm enough. If it's freezing cold, a plant's not going to grow. It needs warmth, it needs sun for energy, and it needs water.
Okay, are we? Yeah. Now, when you're making a non-Newtonian fluid, you can make thicker kinds, you can make more liquidy kinds. I'm going to add a little more water. There's some really great fun videos on the internet of people having giant pools of it where you can run across it.
Yeah, I've seen that.
It's really fun. Really fun to play with. Totally safe for kids at home. It's a bit messy, but you need cornstarch and just water.
Maybe you could do this outside.
Yeah.
This is an outside, not in the living room kind of a thing to do.
Milo asked, when you put pressure, it's solid, and when you let it go, it's a liquid, right?
That's right.
Right.
That's right.
Go ahead. You can hit this.
I think I need a little more.
I need a little more of this.
Yeah. My ratios. It's roughly, I've heard 50-50.
Okay.
Half and half. Half water.
Well,
half.
That looks good.
We'll just mix it up. Start that. Loading.
Amelia asks, how many ways are there to make carbon?
How many ways are there to make carbon? Well, carbon is found naturally. It's a naturally occurring element. It's in our bodies. It's in plants. It's in all living things. Carbon's in all living things, and it's an element that's very common here on Earth. Okay.
I need a little more water. Little here, little there.
Milo's asking, what makes it like that, the non-Newtonian fluid?
Well, it has this behavior that when it gets hit, the shock of hitting, the molecule wraps around each other, like tangles up, and so then it goes rigid. So there's people who have researched this, like putting it in football helmets and things like this, because it can turn it, because of its shape, it can flow like it's a liquid. But then when you hit it, right, like I'll grab a piece here and then I pull it apart, it breaks like it's a solid. So it has all these different properties that people are trying to find uses for. But it's really fun to play with.
A little messy, but yeah. Fun.
Alette asks, what is cornstarch made of?
Cornstarch is just a chemical that comes from corn. Starch is just a product that all plants produce. So it's just a dried out part of the corn plant. And there's your oobleck, part solid, part liquid. All fun. Okay, well, thanks for joining us today. I hope you had fun and learned some things. And we look forward to helping you learn more. And remember, stay curious. Bye for now.
Bye.